our Radio 1 family, our employees, their family members, our listeners, our viewers, our extended family.
And serving the African-American community for over 42 years.
The views and opinions of the guest and host you hear on 1010 WOLB
are not necessarily those of the staff and management of Radio 1, its sponsors, or advertisers.
Hello, hello. Good morning, everyone. Every Friday from 10 to 12 here on 1010 WOLB is the Frank M. Conaway Sr. et al. Show with co-host, attorney Tehma Smith Wilson.
Good morning, once again, Baltimore and beyond. I am Tehma Smith Wilson. I'm an attorney and entrepreneur based out of Baltimore City. Part of our services that we offer include real estate and estate planning. So if you need to buy or sell your property or to purchase your ground rent or update your deed or your will, please give us a call at 667-334-7242. 667-334-7242. And for the listeners who would like to be a part of the conversation with either a comment or a question, and you cannot get through on the phone line, please text your comment or question to 667-334-7242. And if you missed a broadcast, please feel free to go to our YouTube channel where you can catch up on all the past broadcasts. That's the Frank Conaway Sr. Show on YouTube.
All righty. What's on your mind today?
We have a great guest today, and we have a lot of topics that we will cover.
All righty. And our other co-host, attorney Robert Bob the Dean Dashiell.
Good morning, Baltimore. I'm happy to be here. My specialty, as you know, is procurement or government relations, however you want to look at it. My number is 410-547-8820. And for all of those of you who are going to the Preakness tomorrow, please do not block my way down Northern Parkway because I have business. So I appreciate it. Thank you.
Bob, you can talk all you want about that. Your best deal is
stay
to
home.
Find another room.
Right. Oh, stay home.
Because you go anywhere in the internet tomorrow, brother, you are in real trouble.
I do believe you're
especially
right.
Especially with Bruno Mars going to be out there, dude. Oh, no.
Yeah, I believe you're right.
Yeah, that ain't working.
Okay.
yours truly... Carlton C. Douglas of the Carlton C. Douglas Funeral Service, PA. If you need our services, the telephone number to call is 410-669-1738. That's 410-669-1738, specializing in at-need, pre-need, pre-arrangements, seminars, veteran benefits. Veterans, please get your DD-214, cremations, and you know the drill. Everybody need to get some insurance, or you need to increase what you got. Announcement. Well, first of all, if you don't want to cook on Sunday, United House of Prayer for All People, some of the best soul food in the city on Sunday from 12 to 4, and that's located at Edgewood and Liberty Heights, the 3400 block of Edgewood Road, right at Liberty Heights. House of Prayer. And this Sunday, this is the Sunday, y'all, I want y'all to show up. Please show up. You'll be able to meet us, because I'm hoping my co-host is going to come too. Sunday, May 21st, from 4 o'clock, Baltimore is honoring some of the gospel legends in this town. We're honoring Bishop Pompey Swan, Bishop Edna Isaac. As long as this lady lives, Mahalia will never die. And I'm talking about Sister Katie Jackson. Reverend Alverda Winley Bennett. Now, some of us that came up with this young lady know her by her nickname from Mount Olive Free Will, which was Boo. Reverend Peggy Carmichael, a hurricane voice. The last living legend member of the Clara Ward Singers, Dr. Mavlin Statham, Elder Harriet Mooring Noakes, Dr. Roland Joe Smith, the Dean of Gospel Organists in this town, the Lady of the B3 Hammond Organ, Dr. Gloria Thompson, Evangelist Loretta Jackson, and finally, Sister Pearlie Jean Gray. And that's this Sunday, 4 o'clock. At the Gillis Memorial, the home of gospel music, Christian Community Church, 4016 Park Heights Avenue, where the Reverend Dr. Darrell Gould is the pastor. This Sunday at 4 o'clock. Come, bring your shouting shoes with you when you come. And I want to give, we have a special guest on the line. Before we get to them, and Cliff and Mike, we appreciate if you would hold for us, and you may have some questions for our co-host, and if any other persons want to call in, because y'all always holler about you can't get in. Well, when we got lines open, I'll let you know. So you, if I tell you a line is open, you need to go ahead and call in and get on it. 410-481-1010. But I want to give kudos to a great pastor on the east side. One who I have a personal relationship because I watched him grow up from a boy. He grew up in our church at Gillis Memorial. And I'm talking about Bishop Dante Hickman, who for the last two nights had what I felt was an amazing revival service. My wife and I went both nights. We really went Wednesday night because he had on, as the revivalist, there were a double. It was a double revival. He had the Reverend Lance Watson of Richmond, Virginia. And to bring up the rear was a preaching hurricane by the name of Dr. Freddie Haynes out of Dallas, Texas. And I know Dr. Haynes from having been a personal friend to Reverend Dr. Marvis May, who passed away some years ago, used to be the pastor in Macedonia. Then last night, he ended it with Dr. Tillis Chapman from Detroit, Michigan, the verifying pastor of Galilee Baptist. They call him the man from Galilee. And I'm telling you, those three guys just invigorated me. It was just a fantastic revival. I think Bishop Hickman does this every year. It's called Sweet Wine, I believe. This year was Sweet Wine 23. Next year it'll be 24. I don't know who's going to bring next year until I hear. But I would recommend that when it comes, anytime you hear he's bringing some of these guys in like that, he brings in some dynamic preachers from all over the country now and then that you check it out. And we certainly want to give Bishop Hickman his props in trying to do something. Maybe what we need, guys, is a city revival. Because this city definitely needs it. I don't know why they keep going on there talking about the crime rate is so low when every day you're seeing something's going on around here. The homicide rate, we might be below last year, but it is still too high to be as high as it is. Okay? Thank you very much for giving me that time to say that. All right, we got two lines open if you want to call, but remember, we have a special guest we're going to get to first, and I'm going to have, by the way, WOLB streams live at WOLBBaltimore.com. WOLB streams live at WOLBBaltimore.com. That means if you can't hear us too well here on 1010 through the radio, you can get us on the internet, or you can download the app and get it. Tehma?
Good morning once again, Baltimore. Today we have with us Senator Cory McCray. Senator McCray was elected to represent the 45th Legislative District in the Maryland State Senate in 2018. Since that time, he has been named a legislator to watch. Additionally, Cory has also served as first vice chair of the Maryland Democratic Party. Cory's story is a unique Baltimore story. Like many of us, Cory grew up in a Baltimore where the greatest resource was its hardworking men and women. In spite of that resource, the city often struggled to give those men and women the opportunity they deserved. As a teenager at Fairmount Harford High School, Cory was also in search of opportunity. During a brief trip down the wrong path as a teenager, he found out about apprenticeships at the age of 18. The rest is history. By 19, he had become a member of the International Brotherhood of Electrical Workers. By 20, he was a homeowner. Cory continued to meet opportunity halfway, working his way through community college and obtaining a bachelor's degree, all while working and growing a small business focused on rental properties. Those years also brought marriage and 4 children, along with a career focused wholly on working families and the communities they hold dear. Cory continues working for his local union and as a community organizer to this day, helping expand the opportunities for a better life to men and women across the city. In 2014, neighbors across the 45th district elected Cory to represent them in Maryland's House of Delegates. During his time in the House, leading news outlets like Center Maryland called him one of the most effective freshman legislators in the entire state. Cory's approach to public service is listening to his constituents' problems and then figuring out how to solve them. As a 45th district senator, Cory is continuing his mission to bring greater levels of resources and equality to the city of Baltimore. Good morning, Senator McCray. How are you doing today?
Tehma, Bob, Carlton, it is a pleasure to be able to be here with you all and just be able to join the show.
Thank you. One of the reasons we invited you on the broadcast today is because during the last Maryland legislative session, through the way that you voted, you stood out as being a different type of Democrat. Before we go into the various bills and policies that were or were not passed, how do you think the session went as a whole?
I think it was a pretty good session. This is my 9th legislative session. As you stated, I did a tour in the House of Delegates, so I got my training wheels in the House of Delegates and currently serving my second term, my first session into my second term. And through that, you are able to learn a variation of things. I sit on the Budget and Taxation Committee, which is a $60+ billion budget for the state of Maryland. So I was laser focused on making sure that opportunities will come back, not just to East and Northeast Baltimore, but the city of Baltimore as a whole. And also thinking from a policy standpoint, how does that reflect? But this is more as trying to grow as a person, grow as a legislator, educate myself about things that I do not know. I switched subcommittees from that standpoint. I used to be the chair of Public Safety, Transportation, and Environment. So all agency heads under that purview would come and we would appropriate that budget. But this year was my first year on Health and Human Services. So all the health care issues, Medicaid, Medicare, SNAP benefits, and things of that nature. So I use this as an opportunity to just kind of grow as a person, grow as a human being, but more importantly, learn the intense issues that's impacting my people.
Three of the bills that I guess garnished the most attention were the Boost Bill, the Bates Bill, and the Legal Gun Carry Bill.
Okay, I thought you was going to say BBB, but Boost, Bates, and the Concealed Carry.
Right. What was the other B that you were thinking about?
No, I thought you was. I thought it was like coming. So, but I'm good with explaining and articulating why I took the positions that I did on these three bills, and I'm ready whenever you are.
Well, let's begin. Let's get started. So let's start with the Boost Bill.
With the Boost Bill, this is something that's been contentious probably for the last decade, I want to say. One of the things is that I've always been the proponent when the boost come, and I'll tell you that I was actually on the other side of boost because of the discrimination challenges that was taking place, not in the city of Baltimore with IND or Curley or St. Francis, but in the sticks when you have like Cecil County or Harford County, there were known, documented, complaints that were upheld where folks were either discriminating against our young scholars or discriminating against the parents of the young scholars that were going to institutions that were receiving state tax dollars. I'd had a bill in for 5 years, Tehma, and unfortunately, that bill didn't pass until about a year ago. Basically, what we would do is put the discrimination language in the budget every year, but we would never do it in statute. We didn't have the courage to put it in statute. It went in the statute, and as soon as we got rid of the few institutions that were doing some level of discrimination that was documented and upheld, I became a big proponent. I think that from an education standpoint, we are putting forward a long-term plan with the Blueprint for Maryland Success with the Kerwin Bill. But that's 10 years out. That's 15 years out. These are long-term pieces. The challenge is that we have young scholars that are trying their best to get educated within our K-12 system right now, not 10 years or 15 years from now. And this provides that opportunity. I started off talking about being on the Budget and Taxation Committee. It's a $60+ billion. At the end of the day, we were having a conversation about $10 million. So when you're talking about $10 million in a $60 billion conversation, that's less than 1% of what we're talking about. And it was no question for me which direction. It was probably a little bit more contentious because most people wouldn't have saw me go that direction. Most people didn't know, like, I dig into the weeds, I get into the granular level about what's going on. But also, I tell you, one of the things is that I stay in one of my schools at least once a week. So I've consistently visited Curley. I've consistently visited Dr. Turner over at St. Francis and Sister Heidi and the folks over at IND when it was in my district before its closure from that standpoint. But from an educational standpoint, a historical standpoint, St. Francis is one of the oldest institutions, not in the city of Baltimore, not in the state of Maryland, but across this country that first educated black young scholars. And I have a responsibility each and every day that I wake up to make sure that those types of institutions continue to exist in case my kids, my grandkids, or my great grandkids, or our great grandkids want to patronize that institution. And that's another reason why I'm a big proponent or definitely a supporter of making sure that they have the resources that's necessary for our young scholars to be successful.
Thank you. And how about the Bates Bill? We know Delegate Conaway picked it up on the delegate side, and you were the sponsor on the senator side. How was that decision?
Nope, that's another good contentious, you hitting all the spots. But with Ivan Bates, our new city state's attorney, he was elected by the people of the city of Baltimore. I believe that the state's attorney gave a clear, concise message in reference to what his intent was, which is to prosecute those folks that are carrying illegal firearms. That was very clear during the campaign. It was very clear and articulate during since he's been in office. So he came to us and he said he had one priority, which was this bill. No one else picked that bill up, and I wasn't going to pick the bill up, Tehma. Delegate Conaway picked the bill up on the delegate side. And one of the things is unfortunately, our city state's attorney, he wasn't an elected official, so he wasn't as familiar with the legislative process. And one of the things that I reminded him of was that any bill, because he is an agency, can be put in at the request of by the chair of our respective delegation. This happens all the time, whether it's the police commissioner, whether it's the mayor, even with the governor. The governor is not in the legislature. His bills, the governor's bills, go in by the Senate president and the Speaker of the House, and it goes in at the request of the governor. Our city state's attorney has that same ability. So Delegate Conaway took the lead, and I thank him for taking the lead from that standpoint. And when that what that did was it gave me the ability to look at the language. And I saw that our city state's attorney was just trying to close a loophole that exists. The loophole that exists is that when you are 18 to 20, that you were receiving 5 years first offense for carrying an illegal handgun. And if you were 21 and older, that you would receive a 3-year maximum penalty for carrying first time carrying an illegal handgun. He was looking to make that 5 years across the board, no matter what age you are. Tehma, it's important to also note that with the Justice Reinvestment Act that we put forward, that people aren't doing five and they're not doing the entire 3 years. So you're doing about 20% of that time. You're doing about 6 to 9 months on the 3 years, and you're doing about anywhere from 15 to 18 months on 5 years. And what happens is that 6 to 9 or 15 to 18 also depends on where you do that time at. So if it's 6 to 9 months, you're doing a lot of that time, if not all of that time, over central booking. So you're never really making it to the jail from that piece of it. But if you are doing the 15 to 18 months, you're not doing that in Baltimore City at the local jail at central bookings from that standpoint. And that's what the city state's attorney was articulating. Upon seeing what the language was, because of my frustration that we were sending the wrong message to the public, that no one would pick this bill up, I said, Mr. City State's Attorney, I will carry the bill for you. This is important from, and I know, Bob, I know Carlton, you all noticed that from a strategic standpoint, if his bill was not heard in this Maryland State Senate prior to crossover, there could have been an argument made that, well, we never got the chance to fully flush it out. So I wanted him to have the clear opportunity. He was elected by the people. He's closing a loophole, and he's working hard to make sure that he get folks that are carrying these illegal firearms. So I put the bill forward. It had its hearing. He clearly articulated, did a phenomenal job in JPR with his message, what answering the questions from my colleagues and things of that nature. Some of the gamesmanship, my bill wasn't passed, but it gave him the opportunity for folks not to make an excuse to say that it wasn't heard, and it was amended into Luke Clippinger's bill. So mine's in Delegate Conaway's, and that's not what it's always about. It's not about always getting a bill passed. At the end of the day, it's about getting the work done. And the work was done because the bill was amended into another bill, and it actually did get passed. That's the Bates bill in its entirety.
Many of the citizens of Baltimore understood, you know, or they were in favor of the bill. But a lot of the politicians gave pause and they hesitated with sponsoring or trying to promote the bill. What was their hesitation in terms of why they did not specifically, you know, want this bill to proceed?
So I can't speak for my colleagues, but I'll speak to how I carry myself with every bill. What I try to do is at least see the language. So when anybody that tell you that they're reading all 2,000 bills that's introduced, they're lying to you. But what I do try to read is the ones that come through my committee, because I have a responsibility. There's only 13 members, so we're hoping that the committee does its responsibility, because it's the committee of jurisdiction. The delegation, any bill that comes before the Baltimore City delegation, because it's only 5 members, I believe that we have a greater responsibility. And then those bills that come to the Senate floor, I make sure that it before I vote for those from that standpoint. So mine was, I wanted to see the language of what he was trying his best to do, because you can say one thing, and then when you see it in writing, it's a different thing. What I saw in writing was exactly what he was articulating, and I felt confident from that standpoint. I also agree with you. People, when I'm in the streets, when I'm knocking on doors, when I'm talking to the public, they're concerned about people that are carrying illegal firearms, and they want people to be held accountable. He would not have been elected if this wasn't the case, because that was his message also during the campaign from that standpoint.
I'm sorry, go ahead.
Some folks may have, and it's not a right to assume, but some folks are just against increasing any level of a penalty. I understand that we have to take a look at each and every penalty. We have to give it a laser focus from that standpoint. But at the end of the day, we should not be making excuses for folks that are causing heinous actions on our streets, in our neighborhoods, and carrying illegal firearms. And I'm on the same page with the city state.
Senator McCray, Bob Dashiell here. First of all, I'm happy that you were able to join us this morning. And I've met with the state's attorney. I agree with every assessment that you've given of him. But the bottom line here is that the rationale for this was more of a technical change than substantive. Mm-hmm. And here's the reason. The state's attorney Bates said that the reason that he wanted to change it was to be fair to the younger people. He didn't think it was fair that they would be subject to the possibility of a lengthier sentence than people beginning at age 21 on. Well, really, nobody cared. No, the issue of fairness among the criminal set wasn't really an issue that anybody was embraced, I don't think. And the connection between the maximum sentence length and the sentence actually imposed by the judge was not established. So in other words, there was, you know, I support, and I don't think the opponents to the bill are in favor of or any less supportive of accountability for those committing crimes with guns than anybody else. I really think it was much to do about nothing, to be quite honest with you, because I talked to state's attorney Bates about it. I do also agree that it was important. There's an incoming state's attorney that the public. That the legislature, particularly those from Baltimore City, establish a positive connection with him, and so that the public believes that the legislature and the new state's attorney were on the same accord. And I think you established that, and I think that was an important thing to establish.
Hey, Corey.
Yes, sir.
Carlton Douglas. How much you got?
Always good to hear your voice.
Always good to. How much time you got to be with us? Because we got some folk online here that may have a question for you or not.
I plan to be here at least from 10 to 11, Mr. Carlton.
Okay, good.
If the deems, yes, sir.
Okay. Now, before I go to Emma, when I come to the phones, they're coming in this order. Cliff, mm-hmm. Mike, Robert, Carlos, we got one line open if you want to call in, 410-481-1010, 410-481-1010. The question I got for you, the governor last week signed limits on firearms in public. Mm-hmm. He is now being sued. This thing may go to the Supreme Court. I question whether the Supreme Court is going to uphold this. What is the thinking of you and others of the delegation that represents Baltimore City, especially on this, because that's where the real problem is, on how this thing is going to pan out?
Well, that was the third one that Tehma put forward, was the concealed carry bill, Senate Bill 1. And I dissented in a different direction than majority of my colleagues in reference to Senate Bill 1. So I believe that it was only three of us that voted against that bill. Three of us in reference to Democrats, myself, Antonio Hayes, and Kathy Klausmeier moved in a different direction with the party from that standpoint. I think that it sent the wrong message to the public in reference to what we were doing around just murders, attempted murders. borders, illegal firearms, just in general. I think that the only thing that we did in reference to public safety was the Bates bill from that piece, and we didn't do enough. And I think that the public was asking for us to do more. So I think it sent the wrong message. I also think that the folks that have concealed carry aren't the problem in the streets, to be honest with you, Mr. Carlton. So when you think about the folks that are committing the crimes, it's with illegal firearms. Mm-hmm. A person that takes their time out to register their firearm, they take the classes to get the training and put the hours into their into carrying the firearm. I think that they understand the rules, the regulations that are put forward, and they're not, they should not be under attack by the state of Maryland in reference to their constitutional rights.
Well, I can't.
It'll be.
Senator, I beg to differ. At least with respect to mass shootings, seven out of the 9 mass shootings that occurred in the state of Texas were all by people carrying who got the guns legally. 19 of the mass shootings that have occurred in the state of Texas over the last decade were by people who got their guns legally. The problem is, quite frankly, the question is who. How can we know in advance who is inclined to use a gun illegally? Putting aside how they got it or who they got it from. And the problem is we can't know because we can't read anybody's mind. So then not being able to tell in advance who's likely to use a gun illegally, what course is there to follow other than to restrict the use of the gun itself? I hear people talk. I mean, the Second Amendment is not sacrosanct. There are many constitutional rights that we have that are qualified in terms of the individual application for the benefit of society as a whole. I don't really see. I mean, who really needs to have a gun in church? Who really needs to have a gun at dinner? Who really needs those things? And so I think that reasonable limitations, given the fact that we have no alternative to knowing in advance who's likely to use it illegally. I think those are reasonable limitations that I am a bunch of people I think are willing to live with.
Well, so specifically,
I want to step in here just a little bit, Mr. Dashiell. So one of the things is that you compared us to Texas. So it's important to remember that Maryland is actually a leader, has a lot more stringent rules than places like Virginia, places like Texas in reference to getting a firearm. So you can't get a handgun the next day. You have to wait that 7 days before you. Like, we have a very, very different policy than there. So when you talk about the mass shootings, it's not happening in the state of Maryland. Not to say that they don't happen,
right?
But like, that's not something that you see this year or everyday occurrence where you're seeing it in other states from that standpoint. And other states do need to have tougher gun laws, but I don't think that that's the case for the state of Maryland. I also want to say, like, we restricted it, Mr. DeShields, to where you can basically carry your gun in your house and in your car. In your house and in your car. So you're not concealed carrying anywhere else without being arrested or without being charged from that standpoint, unless you're in your house or in your car. And that's not the right way to do policy.
Well, Cory, here's my thing. I understand where Bob coming from, but Bob, this ain't Texas. Wait a minute. The other thing, my wife and I talked about this this morning. If I am a legally, legitimately strapped, sitting in a restaurant, ready to eat, and some fool comes in there with the dark trench coat on or whatever and pulls out a gun, and I'm strapped, if it look like he getting ready to shoot, I'm going to get him first. Now you restricting me to even have the right as a legally strapped person to protect myself in a public place. Now, I understand sitting in church with a gun ain't, ought not be. Now, although, and I said on my show the other day, I knew a pastor, the Reverend Dr. Our Local Kids, pastor of Cornerstone Church Christ, who would sit in that altar every Sunday strapped. Now, only a few of us knew about it. He ain't advertising. But if you came in Cornerstone, get ready to start something, or get ready to steal something, you was going to be right laying at the altar.
You're making my point.
I want to say something.
Go ahead.
I agree with Mr. Dashiell in terms of you never know the mindset of someone
right.
carrying a gun.
Yeah, I do too.
Whether it's a legal gun or an illegal gun.
Right.
But when you look at mass shootings, how many mass shootings have taken place in a church, in a school, or in a mosque?
Well, how many?
Let me finish.
Go ahead.
So if I have the mindset that I want to do a mass shooting, I would, number one, go to a church because I know there's going to be hundreds of defenseless
right.
people
right.
sitting in there, and I can kill how many? As many as I want because no one in that church is going to have a gun. I can go to a school and kill as many children as I want because no one in that school is going to have a gun. When is the last time there was a mass shooting at a police station? Because everyone in there has a gun. So I have a big problem with restricting the right of a legal gun owner to protect themselves in a mass place.
I can tell you right now, I don't know about your church. My church has a security guard every Sunday strapped. So if somebody show up in there, it's going to be a problem. And I suggest that all churches that can afford it do that too. Go ahead, Bob.
The reason I bring up Texas is because that's one of the jurisdictions where it's easiest to carry gun or whatever.
Yeah.
But in those jurisdictions, the people using the guns are not those in defense of themselves at churches. They're not the mass shootings are not occurring at churches, and not because the people that have guns to defend themselves. The people with the guns doing the shooting are those with the legal weapons. Mm. That's the whole point.
But yeah.
Let me finish. So
hurry up because we got a full board here.
Well, the issue is, we cannot, the people with legal weapons are the ones committing the mass shootings, whether in Texas and Maryland or any place else. The people who shot in the church in Virginia, he had the weapon illegally. So the idea that you should not look at those having guns legally in terms of restricting the way they can carry them is bogus. Now, does that mean that you should the restriction should be as broad as it was under Senate Bill 1? I don't know. Maybe it should be less broad. But that's who you have to look at, because we can't control the people who have the guns illegally, and that's the problem.
Like Senator McCray said, Maryland is different from any other state. When is the last time that someone with a legal gun did a mass shooting in Maryland?
When did someone with a legal gun defend themselves in Maryland? Never.
A person with a legal gun, right?
Yeah.
Defended themselves. Is
Twice.
That what you're saying?
Twice.
Ridgeview Avenue and Pelham Avenue
Twice.
This year.
And Twice.
And we're less than, but that's in my district. We have 5 legislative districts. Those are the ones that I know of.
Right.
Okay.
If other people maybe had a legal gun, maybe they wouldn't be dead because they didn't have something to defend themselves with someone with a legal gun came up against them.
Okay. Let's see what the folk got to say. We're coming to Cliff, Mike, Robert, Carlos, and Joe, if you got a question for the senator, get it out of the way. Senator, try to be as brief but concise as you can in answering, because we got a full board here, and we know we only got you for 20 minutes. If you don't have a question for the senator, come in with whatever you call for, and let's get it over with.
Okay.
Cliff, you're on air.
All right, thanks for taking my call. I'll get right to the point. First of all, I want to make a statement that, without a doubt, we as black people should exercise our Second Amendment right and bear arms. There's no question about it. And a good person with a gun is the one that can stop a bad person with a gun. But here's my point. Where are the illegal guns coming from, Senator, in the black community and all across this country? Where are they coming from? Illegal guns.
No, you're right.
Thank you, Cliff.
The manufacturing that's taking place with the ghost guns, the amount of guns that's coming on the street, the police are confiscating record numbers each and every year, and it's only getting worse with the illegal guns.
Mike, you're on air. Got a line
hey,
over. Got one line over, 410-481-1010. Go ahead, Mike.
All right, Carlton, I want to talk about Hunter Biden and the Biden thing investigation. You know, I think it's a double standard. And I mentioned that these files that were found in Trump's home and in Biden's home was the status quo. That they've been using them to sell to foreign agents or foreign countries.
Well, first of all,
all
Mike,
along.
Hold it, Mike. First of all, the whistleblower, whoever was supposed to show up to even testify, that they can't even find. So I think that's a moot point until they come up with some recommendations or something showing that, and like I have said on these airs over and over, if you're going after Biden's son, then I want to know that you're going after Trump's kids too. Let's go. Robert, you're on air. Robert. Robert, you're on air.
I have a solution for these problems with these juveniles stealing automobiles. First of all, the juvenile steals a car, he should not be released in the custody of his parent. They are criminals, and they deserve a bail. And if the parent can't pay the bail, then they need to be put in juvenile detention. And once they go through that door in detention, all payments from welfare, whether it's a check or food stamps, stop. If they're getting SSI payments, that's stopped. And the quickest way to get somebody's attention is to put your foot in their hind parts or to put your hand in their pocket. And we need a kick-ass law that if juvenile steals a car, they should do 365 days in juvenile detention. And if the parent is working, then the court should put a lien on their income to make whoever was damaged right again.
Well, all I can say to you, Robert, you must didn't listen last week when we had Jill on, and you should have been able to ask that question because Jill was dealing with that juvenile bill. Now, Corey, do you have anything to say toward what he just mentioned about?
I got nothing to add.
Okay. Brother Carlos, you're on air.
Yeah.
Got a question for the senator?
Yeah. Good morning, Senator. My question has to do with education. Recently, the state of New York, which has one of the largest school systems in the nation, adopted a phonics system-based teaching base for their elementary and K through 12 students. They think that the phonics system, which relates to sounding out the alphabet and connecting it to words, would be a great system for teaching our kids to read. Are you aware of whether that system is used in Maryland, and would you look into whether we should adopt that system if it is not used in Maryland? That's my question.
No problem at all. Mr. Carlos, I don't mind. First, I'm not aware of the system that you're talking about. I think that everything should be explored to make sure that we're given every opportunity to our young folks. And I say that as a father of four children that's in the public school system.
Okay. Joe, you are on the air. We have a couple lines open. 410-481-1010. 410-481-1010.
Hi, sir.
Joe, you're on air.
All right. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning. You got a question for me? You got a question for
me? Yeah, I do.
Uh-huh.
And also, I just want the senator to know that I was one of the very first ones that voted for him and gave him permission to put his sign on my yard.
No, I appreciate that.
I live in Northeast Baltimore. But anyway, here's my question. And I'm with you on this, Senator. Why are you restricting law-abiding citizens and you got all these lawless criminals running around out here? Here's someone who's legally able to cut with somebody in mind. Because trust me, before you get these classes, your mental stability will be checked. You know what I mean? And so that is all I have to say. And thank you, Senator, for voting against that bill.
Senator McCray.
Thank you and definitely appreciate it. Yes, ma'am.
Senator McCray, I have a question. When you vote, because I know a lot of people, you know that Democrats do not stray too far away from the Democratic quote-unquote agenda. When you vote the way that you have, which may be different from the majority, is there any type of backlash that you receive?
People ask that question. I think that folks know that I'm very consistent. I communicate well, so I typically tell when I'm trying my best to look through any bill that's introduced as soon as it hit the website. I usually let the sponsor know and whoever that chairperson is know that in the posture that it's in, I'm more than likely will go a different direction. And sometimes if I know it's still going to roll, I'll try my best to get my issues worked through. Similar to the cannabis bill that was introduced, I had had several issues with that bill. And what I did was I wrote a letter to the respective chairs, and I wrote a letter to the Senate president letting them know the issues, and the issues was worked through. Unfortunately, with Senate Bill 1, even if you can't beat a bill up to where then it's not my bill, but if there is some middle to be met, I would like to get there. But if there's no middle to be met, you just wholeheartedly disagree, you have to go against it. But I think that I'm consistent. I think that I communicate and articulate very clear. And I think I'm still respectful even when I disagree with a piece of policy. And that's okay. That's why it's 141 people in the House of Delegates. That's why it's 47 people in the Maryland State Senate to make sure that we come up with a good byproduct that we're putting in place for over 6 million plus people.
Senator, question. You raise a question, and the answer could be important. Is there, or at any time during the legislative session or otherwise, a meeting or gathering of the so-called, of the ones who declare themselves to be Democrats to decide collectively how the, quote, party, what position the party would take on a particular piece of legislation? And if so, to what extent are the members of the party bound by such a decision?
So there are caucuses. There's a Democratic caucus. There's a Black caucus. There's a Women caucus. So there's a Hispanic caucus. There are these caucuses that exist. And you try your best to talk it through. Mm-hmm. You try your best to air it out and see if there's some middle. But there are issues where there isn't a middle, and you still have to make a decision. And it is to some degree, you feel some level of nervousness, but there's not any really the level of nervousness, because if you feel as though you're doing the right thing, like you're doing it because you have a good pulse of the people. And we have to remember that Baltimore City is different than the Eastern Shore. Eastern Shore is different than Western Maryland. Western Maryland is different than Howard County. And like, that's why we're here making, from that standpoint, on behalf of our constituents.
So let me ask,
I get a number of folks that come up and say, thank you for doing the right thing in reference to SB1. Folks will email, like, it's just been like, thank you for just standing up, because they feel like no one is standing up sometimes in those different challenging positions.
Let me ask a better question. Do you believe that you're, and I understand you're not a mind reader, but do you believe that your colleagues, as you do, vote for what they believe in, or vote the way that they believe that the party wants them to vote?
Yeah, I wouldn't be able to speak for, but I know that my intent is always to make sure that I'm voting and doing the right thing for people versus from a party standpoint.
Okay.
Okay, so we're coming to Leo, James, Chuck, Dolly. We got a line open, 410-481-1010. We only got 10 minutes, so we're trying to get everybody in as quickly. Go ahead, Tehma.
We talked about the way that the parties vote, but is there ever a conflict between your donors and the way that the citizens or the voters might want you to vote? And how do you overcome that if it is?
Yeah, at the end of the day, like, donors donate, but like, if you're agreeing with somebody 100%, then you're really not like doing your specific job. So like, there is disagreement with everybody from that. You're just not going to be 100% with somebody all the time from that standpoint. But as long, and I go back to it, I'm very clear in my communication. When folks ask me what's my position on different bills, I quickly articulate and try to get in the weeds, get at a granular level to be able to explain it. And if I don't know what my position is, when that bill comes before me voting, they're not going to hear about it from my voting record. I'm going to call them up. I'm going to say, hey, here's the direction that I'm going, and these are the reasons why I'm going. And that may be on the same page with them, or it may not be on the same page.
Okay. Leo, you're on the air quickly.
Yes, good
morning.
You
got a question for the Senator?
Good morning, everyone. I agree with Senator Cory McCray's stance on concealed weapons. My question to Senator McCray is, will he assist those of us who are activists in determining what happens to confiscated illegal guns and drugs in the city of Baltimore? There have been questions asked of the police department, and they are refusing to say what happens to them or provide statistical data on what's happening to those guns and drugs that are confiscated by the police, allegedly.
Yep.
Thank you, Leo. That's something Bill Gooden been working on for years, Senator. What's your answer to that?
Yep. So, Mr. Leo, first, it's just always good to hear you, and a deep respect for everything that you do from an activist standpoint. And he raises a good point. So the police department was not, they were basically self-auditing. They were self-policing from that standpoint until we passed a bill where the state of Maryland currently has to audit the police department from that standpoint. That triggered about 3-4 years ago because of a bill that I was able to lead on in the Maryland State Senate, like my first year in the Maryland State Senate. And one of the things that Mr. Leo is talking about is anytime a gun is confiscated, that information is supposed to be reported to the state police. So when we found out from the audit that that information for several years wasn't being reported to the state police, I then, with the budget that the Baltimore Police Department, because they do get some state money, I know that they get a bulk of their money, majority of their money from the city of Baltimore, but there are funds that are given by the state of Maryland, and we restricted about $500,000 until each and every one of those reports were turned in. So the process is that not only do they document it, but they also have to burn those respective guns. I think that they also invited some community members or council members, elected officials to go to, I believe it's in Pennsylvania, to witness that process. But mine's is, if they're not turning in the information to the MSP of like how many guns are being confiscated, what is happening to the guns and things of that nature, even if it is happening, it's not happening because it's not being documented. Mm. And I'm glad that they've started to have some level of a correction course. But if it's any information that Mr. Leo is looking for from that standpoint, I don't mind getting with the police commissioner and being able to articulate. And it was not easy. Even as an elected official, it was not easy to put the pressure points for our police department to do the right thing. And they didn't respond until the restriction of the budgetary dollars is when they started to get the messaging.
James, you're on air. James.
Hey, how you guys doing? This is James from Pennsylvania. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Yeah, I got a question for the senator. With you going after gun control, aren't you going to alienate your largest base, which is black women? Because they're the fastest growing gun group in America.
What is he talking about?
Nah, I don't think that that's the case. You'll see that gun ownership amongst black folks have went up drastically high from that standpoint. When you go to the range, you'll see a number of folks, especially women, that are participating and legally carrying, legally sporting, legally shooting, and just being able to be trained in reference to self-defense.
Well, that was a good question, because the other day that was a hot topic on another talk show that's very popular in this city about black women who are now strapping up. So that was a good question.
I was going to say, I know a number of black women that carry.
Yeah. So. Chuck, you on air.
Yeah, good morning. Yeah, it seemed like the gun manufacturers.
Wait a minute, hold on. Do you have a question for the senator?
Oh, no. I just want to make a comment real quick.
Well, make it very quick, because we got to get out of here in a few.
Okay. Yeah, seemed like the gun manufacturers will get a pass again. They keep calling ghost guns, but the gun manufacturers are doing multi-gun sales, and they're making guns and not putting a stamp on it, and so they just label it a ghost gun, and they're getting away with it. And that's why there's so many guns in the city, and that's what's happening.
Okay. Senator McCray, I got a question for you. What is a bill that did not pass that you wish would have passed in terms of the difference that it would have made in the state of Maryland and the city of Baltimore?
One of them that I worked on was in reference to Back River. It made national news about how we have our wastewater treatment facilities. It made it out the Senate. It didn't make it out the House. But one of the things is that, like, we get federal dollars, we get state dollars and things for the capital. But like the maintenance, it's the workers. The workers are not making enough down at that specific facility. It's not enough workers that's at that facility. And right now we're subsidizing what we call Maryland Environmental Services at a very premium rate, when we could be making sure that we have the employment levels or the staffing down there to make sure that that facility works. That was one of the bills. It's not super like in the weeds. People aren't thinking about it. But from a wastewater, from an environmental standpoint, we're not doing what we're supposed to do. And we watch our water bills go up because of it.
And it was interesting that you would say that, because one of the callers, Miss Washington, asked, why isn't Baltimore City going to begin working on the Equalized Water Requirements until December 2023? Is that because of the lack of workers, or?
I'm not sure the specific, like, that that information, but just I know that that's a big issue for me because, like I said, it made national news in addressing the stuff that's happening at Back River and Patapsco. Unfortunately, I think that the state should have more of a responsibility because it's not just the Baltimore City that's benefiting from it, but other adjacent counties that are impacted by the wastewater that's coming out of Alpha.
Go ahead, Dolly. You're on air.
I wanted to know from the senator, I'm a senior and a retiree. I wanted to know what bills specifically were passed that benefit seniors.
I think that from affordable housing, making sure that folks have affordable housing opportunities and making sure that we pump more affordable housing within our spaces, especially for those folks that actually own their home, that have lived and given 30, 40 years of their life in their home, and making sure that the resources are there from that. That's some of the things that we were able to do from a neighborhood, from a senior standpoint, and the longevity of our neighborhoods.
Okay. Coming from a person who did an apprenticeship, we know you've done a lot of work in the legislature in terms of creating apprenticeship opportunities. There are a lot of opportunities out there for young men. My question is, how do we get young men like you were at the age of 18 interested in these opportunities? Because they're there. It just doesn't seem as if they're taking a great advantage of them.
I think it's one thing that we could do is just expose them to our greatest ability. I tell you, Tehma, like, I didn't know about what an apprenticeship was graduating from Fairmont Harford at the time. My mom actually reached out to the Department of Labor and said, send me every apprenticeship program in the state of Maryland. She was like, either you join the military, you get a job. And I just went and put in applications. So by the grace of God, I was able to find the apprenticeship opportunity. How do we do more exposure? We did something a couple weeks ago where we took the five high schools that are in my district, Reach, City Neighbors, Dunbar, NAF, and Reginald F. Lewis, and we toured apprenticeship programs all day long. We take our young scholars to colleges and universities, but you have to question, why don't we expose them from that standpoint? That's one of the things. I think Mr. Carlton rushing me because I hear something.
Yep.
But those are one of the things that we do from an apprenticeship
Jason, standpoint. You got 15 seconds to ask the question and 15 seconds, Corey, to answer.
I think that was great, Senator, by the way.
Good morning. Again, Senator, I thank you for the work that you did. I know that myself and Yolanda Pulley, we both submitted testimony in favor of the bill. The problem is when we talk about the Texas.
Hold it. Ask the question. We ain't got that kind of time, Jason.
Well, the problem is in Texas,
Jason,
the majority of the shootings
Jason,
that have gone
Jason,
on have been people
Jason,
that have had mental health
Jason,
issues.
Jason, do you have a question for the senator?
I do, but I have to pose.
No, ain't no posing. We don't have that kind of time.
The question is that what can we do in reference to clearing up the loopholes between the fact that these folks that are committing these mass shootings have all been identified as having mental health issues.
Okay. Could you answer that quickly, Corey? Because we're getting ready to go to the second hour.
Yep. When you do the application, there are mental health questions in reference to a Maryland application. The other states need to tighten up their laws.
Okay. Well, we certainly thank you for taking time out of your busy schedule. We could have gone into the second hour with you because we had a full war going here for a while.
I did feel like it was rapid fire. Yeah.
Can you stay another hour?
I do have to jump back into some work, Mr. Shields, but okay. I don't mind coming back on another period,
great,
another time.
Okay, we'd be glad to have you back.
Deep respect for each and every one of you.
I want you to call me off air because I got another thing I want to talk to you about when you get an opportunity,
sir.
If you can today. Okay, you got my number.
Thanks,
okay.
Senator.
Well, we certainly want to thank you, Senator. We want to thank Tehma for inviting you on. We appreciate you. And anytime you want to come on and let us know what's happening, please let us know.
Thanks, Senator McCray.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Y'all have a blessed day.
Okay. Same to you.
Okay, we're getting ready to go into the second hour of the Frank M. Conaway Sr. and Al Show here on 1010 WOLB. Don't touch that dials. We got many, many things to talk about concerning in and outside of the state. We appreciate you. We love you.
A boy born in Hot Mississippi, surrounded by four other